He plays John, a writer exploring his own Celtic backyard.
When I set out for Lyonnais, 100 miles away, the rime was on the spray and starlight lit my lonesomeness. When I set out for Lyonnais, 100 miles away, what would perchance at Lyonnais? It's the mine shaft. Another step would have killed me. If I throw a stone in, I can count the seconds and gauge how deep it is. Now, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. If I shout into the hole, will it accept me?
John! John!
When I set out for Lyonnais, 100 miles away.
No, Mrs. Treviles, not very ill. Migraines and nerves, insomnia. It's a lovely room.
Oh, well, you sleep well enough in Lithaustow, Mr. John. You've got your view and the sound of the sea.
I want to do a lot of walking while I'm here. Will you help me with a map if I spread it out on the table?
No, not much good at maps, my lover. A mira curthas in Lent. That's Cornish for I walk slowly. Gentlemen like the coast walk. Past the lighthouse, onto Thorny Cliff. You can get tea there and walk back in time for your evening meal.
Well, that phrase was interesting.
Mira curthas in Lent, yes. I walk slowly.
I suppose you all speak Cornish down here among yourselves.
No, sir. Alas, we do not. Cornish speaking is unfortunately rare.
It's a wonderful view from this room. The cliffs are a strange dark green. Very dark. And the sunlight slides over them like windows opening in the rock. Is it very old rock?
One of the very oldest, they tell me. A serpentine, they call it. You'll buy a souvenir or two up in the village. An ashtray, a barometer set in green serpentine stone to remind you of the Cornish weather.
It's strange that the very oldest stone that began the earth should be green, like the trees. I hope the sky stays clear tonight. I love the stars.
Oh, now, you take care walking at night, Mr. John. We don't do much of that around here. There's the telly in the front room and the pub if you want company.
I saw that splendid ensign on the way down. A great snake coiled round the cliffs.
The old dragon. Well, it's very cosy at the pub, but you mustn't mind if they teach you a bit, being a visitor. It's all in good heart.
Well, how about this road across the moor, and then the path? It's a village called Lithaustow, south of the Lizard.
John, I don't want you to go down there by yourself. You'll get mad again with nobody to talk to.
We're in between books, Clements, and as much as I love our literary collaboration, I think I can do without your stimulating company for a day or two.
Thanks.
I've never been to Cornwall, and this is the deepest part of it. It's nearly as far south as you can get. I can't quite say it's unspoiled, but it's kept its power. It's all very well our writing books together about earthquakes and volcanoes and climatic anomalies and UFOs, but we haven't actually tried to find out about what's happening in our own mysterious Celtic backyard.
Britain is such a stable little isle.
Well, that's just my point. If the changes in the land are slow, human beings have a chance to respond to them. Perhaps legends grow more leisurely from the earth of our native soil. That could be the theme of our next book.
It'll be time to start thinking about your next book when you've recovered from the last one. And me too.
They say Cornwall's a place strange in ways that have never been told. Legends coil like snakes around such places. Like the low, muttered stories of the Earth Dragon itself.
There is a book in it. You're showing all the signs. Don't let it get out of hand, though.
As soon as I got over the Tamar at Launceston, I felt a change. I have never seen anything as dark and lonesome as that Bodmin Moor. Exclamatory garage notice. Last petrol before Bodmin Moor. As though it would be a terrible disaster to break down there. There is said to be a great hand on Bodmin that snatches cars off the road. Then to Truro, nestling in its valley. Then on beyond the wooded creeks of Gweek. Up onto Goonhilly Down and the enormous Telstar dish aerials listening to the stars. It was strange to stop and try and get a better look at the radio telescope balls and find that the perimeter fence had been carefully indented to make room for an ancient standing stone. I wondered what electricity that was drawing out of the earth. Then on to the Lizard, strange name, and beyond, drawing up to Mrs. Treville's place. It seemed I'd come home.
Inland walks, then. How about this road across the moor, and then the path? A little tucked-in valley, so winding, so secretive. This one has a mine at its head and a little stream.
That's Nan's Trelamia, Trelamia's valley.
I thought you were no good at maps.
We don't go there much. You do better on the moors. There's snakes in those little valleys.
Snakes? Nonsense! No, I beg your pardon. A few adders, maybe. Very well, then, Mrs. Treviles, I'll take your advice. No snakes. Can you pack me a lunch with some sandwiches, please? Well, that woman's got a damn cheek telling me where to walk. Once up on the moor, I can climb down into Trelamere's valley. Which way's the moor? I can hear water, though. That will take me into the valley. Well, this is Lioness for you. This is Merlin country. Why, here's a clearing. Let me see. Yes, 5 trees standing in a perfect circle. Oh, it must be a magic circle. Entering it, should I cross myself with some emblem older than Christianity? I will close my eyes and step through. Now, I open them again. Oh, my God! Another step would have killed me. Here where the parapets fall away, it's the mine shaft. Strange. As I opened my eyes again, the wood seemed full of snakes, but it's only sunlight among the littered twigs. If I throw a stone in, I can count the seconds and gauge how deep it is. Now! 1, 2, 3, 4, 5... They go on, reflecting, rebounding, like the echoes of a city underground. Like the sea breathing. I must see into the shaft. There's something shining down there deep in the darkness. Water, maybe, or a great boulder of quartz. Oh, the smell of the deep earth is sweeter to me than any of the flowers on its surface. Why did I say that? I'm not sure that it's true.
John! John! Lioness! Lioness!
What's the time? How long have I been here? Oh, this is beautiful. A waterfall falling from a little cliff onto rock. The water has carved a kind of cauldron into which it falls and overflows. The undergrowth here is impenetrable. I'll take my shoes and socks off and paddle down the valley in the stream. Ooh. It's chilly. There, I swear that was a snake uncoiling on that rock. My, they're fast. I hope I don't meet one swimming in the stream. The stream itself is like a great snake, walking the snake path. The water's warmer here. The trees have joined overhead to make a tunnel. There's bright sunlight ahead, and there through the arch a green lawn and tables with umbrellas and a neat stone cottage.
Thank you. draw not nigh hither. Put off thy shoes from off thy feet, for the place whereon thou standst is holy ground.
I beg your pardon?
I saw you step out of the stream, your shoes in your hands and your trousers rolled up. Oh, I had to say something appropriate. Would you like tea now?
And the angel of the Lord appeared unto him in a flame of fire out of the midst of the bush. Well, it's the first time I've heard of an angel offering tea.
Anything can happen in Cornwall. It'll be a Cornish crane tail be wanting my flower.
I saw no burning bush up there, but I nearly fell into a mine.
That'll be Valley of Trelamia. The locals think it's haunted.
I saw nothing except a majestic hole in the ground that echoed when I shouted into it and made me forget what time it was.
Oh, then you're all right. It has accepted you. Or so they would say.
Well, you're not a local, then?
Partwise. I was born here and returned here. My name is Trelamia. Rose Trelamia, like the valley.
Ah, Lady of the Manor, then.
No, it's just my name. This cottage is where I was born. My mother sold it to a distant cousin and we went up country when I was a baby. Eventually, I inherited the cottage. I must put the kettle on.
Let me help you.
Dadaladui. That means thank you, or God repay you.
Your cottage is as beautiful inside as out.
Ah, the books. You're a scholar like myself.
You haven't told me your name.
In a sense, we've met already. This is one of the books I wrote with Clemens. Earthquake Power. Oh, you've underlined it.
In real earthquakes, everything happens so fast. But before it begins, the snakes awake, the animals will not be confined in stall or byre, and people have the vividest dreams. A slow earthquake would create legends, for the land is speaking to you. Do you believe that?
I believe the land speaks. It's why I came to Cornwall.
You must understand the tragedy of this land. Since ancient times, tin and copper have been mined here. The land has given of its people and ores selflessly. You'll find Egyptian roots in many Cornish words, and this is why. Piga, to sting or bite in Cornish. Paca, to sting or bite in Egyptian. Prif, a worm in Cornish. Same word in Egyptian. Saith, a Cornish arrow. Saiti, an Egyptian arrow. And so on.
You are a scholar.
There's more than words to Cornwall. Look at this ring. I inherited it with the cottage.
Oh, the stone is like a blue bead with a wriggly yellow line going through it.
It's called a Cornish meal prie for 1,000 snakes. It is an adder stone. It's worn by a Cornish person who can expel curses, a peller, a healer. It's said to be made from the breath of 1,000 snakes. It is called glain in Welsh, or gloin, which means darkly shining, like black glass. The Cornish word is glan, for the shine on glazed earthenware. The Egyptian word is also glain. Can you tell me the connection between snakes, healing powers, and a shining like glass?
I saw something shining deep in that mine, and the wood seemed full of snakes.
They are said to be the ghosts of the miners who were killed here 100 years ago, when the man engine crashed hundreds of feet into the deepest part of the mine, loaded with all the men and all the boys. The valley had a bad reputation when I came here. It was only my name and this ring which made me acceptable. But the hair almost spoilt everything.
A hair?
I found a hare crouching behind a stone on the moor. It seemed injured. It allowed me to pick it up and comfort it. Did you know that close up a hare's fur dazzles with colours like a rainbow? But it's an unlucky thing to do in these parts. Miners will not work, fishermen will not take a boat out if a hare crosses their path. The people thought I was able to hypnotise hares and a witch, therefore. I never guessed what was wrong until Joshua, who makes the serpentine balls, told me. He's a kind of Cornish saint, I think. It was he who insisted that I was no witch but a peller because of my adder ring and the healing. But only the tourists would enter Trelamere's valley. Until you came.
I'm not surprised. Getting here is like treading a labyrinth full of snakes and trapdoors.
Bless you. Not entirely. Look over there. That is the road. Why else would I put a sign out with my phone number on it saying luncheons and cream teas? I've even got a car.
I think I was pixelated. the contours of the wood seemed very confusing. I had to follow the stream.
And they say it's the little folk. Tourists rather enjoy it, I think. Being overcome and left vague for a moment, because the landscape seems to shift and alter, and you can't remember where you were or what it looked like a moment ago.
Well, I think it is the spirits of nature, which we call changes of the weather. The vast electrical cliffs slipping down in the sky, avalanches of invisible lightning. And I think there is weather travelling under our feet, too. Earth power. It looked like snakes flickering to my startled mind lost in the wood. Tell me about the healing.
It seemed to happen by accident. I was in the village, and a woman beckoned me out of the back door. She looked worried, and I went to see what was the matter. There was a child in a high chair. Oh, its cheek was a mass of impetigo. The woman took my hand questioningly and pressed it to that horror, the hand with the adder stone on it. It was strange, but I felt an odd thrill to be touching so horrible a thing. The woman took my hand away after a time and motioned me to rinse and wash at the kitchen tap. She gave me an envelope with a pound coin in it. A week later, I saw the child in its pushchair and its cheeks were smooth. Joshua says healing has always been symbolised by the snake. He says earth power is love itself to those attuned to it. He says it's why the beautiful stone he makes his souvenir boxes and jars out of is called serpentine.
Oh.
Here's one. Touch it.
It's getting near sunset. I'll lose my way in the dark wood.
Stay a while longer. Go by the road.
I'll always come and go by your labyrinth, Trelamia.
Like a hero, rescuing the lady guarded by a serpent that coils round and round a pile of treasure.
The treasure is the lady.
The treasure is the lady and the hero and the serpent.
Do with a drink.
Here we are, sir. You're looking prayer wished.
A pint of local, please. Excuse me, what did that man say when I came?
Oh, Joshua. He doesn't mean anything by it, my bird. He just said you looked a bit pale. Up country folk do our eyes.
It's Joshua who has the serpentine wax.
That's him, sir.
Will you have a drink with me?
Like a shot. It'll be another pint of bitter.
Oh, good. Here you are.
You?
Have you a phone? Clemens, I think I've got a new book. I met a remarkable woman, Rose. Rose Trelamia. Lives in an out-of-the-way valley. She has theories about the earth energy creating legends and dreams in unspoiled places or in places where the earth has been opened up. They're very similar to mine. She calls it snake breath. She's a kind of guardian of the valley and a healer. No, I'm not thinking of her as co-author.
When I set out for Lioness 100 miles away, the rime was on the spray, and starlight lit my lonesomeness. When I set out for Lioness,
Rose! Oh, I should have rung. Oh, she won't mind if I look inside the house. Oh, the books. Bearing Gold, Borlase, Quilla Cooch. A complete wall of books about Cornwall. And here, Legends of the Serpent, Mysteries of the Worm, more books on the snake cult, The Snake Mother and the Cretan Labyrinth. Oh, here's my book. Another underlining. Earthquakes are probably so disorientating to humans because of the flood of information unconscious to us which floods in. For many days before an earthquake, the human population reports strange and vivid dreams and even visions. Apparitions of the Virgin Mary, the dead, and of gigantic snakes are common at this time. Hallucinations of voices issuing from the ground are also frequent. Once you've been down in an earthquake cleft, you know when the earth's alive. Oh, look at this. Over the back of the sofa. A great snake skin. How beautiful. It gleams and refracts the light like quartz. Oh, the walk has made me drowsy. I'll stretch out for a while.
Gull you, appease you in fen. The gown and gowl, I vastry.
Oh, yes, Joshua, I recognise that. From the Cornish poem of the Passion. Watch and pray with diligence for fear of the devil and his power. Do you believe in the devil?
The devil was at work in your valley once, not too long ago. The man engine was ill-serviced, and 40 men and boys fell to their death. Some say it was not greed at all, nor was the Englishman who owned the mine to blame. It was the land itself, angry at the mining. They say the Serpent of the Rocks moved, and it was the earth tremor that broke the man engine. In Irno Fado Gris, a Grays Olan Bees a Fish, the Wolgo Brays Avi Gris, a Moy Marcus Mia Gris, and Owl a Golaf to Fate, is an Renna Bay in West.
Then there was an earthquake. It went over all the world, and there was a great darkness it made. The sun forgot itself.
The sun lost its semblance.
The sun lost its semblance, and there were many more wonders.
And more wonders, I believe, than these also occurred. There.
Oh, a really beautiful little chalice in serpentine. I don't know how you can bear to sell it.
Maybe I'll keep it. Maybe I'll give it to somebody.
John, dear, wake up.
Hmm?
Wake up.
What is it? Oh, Rose. Oh, I was dreaming that I was down in the mine. It was full of lights and palaces.
There's something I want to show you. Outside. It's here, where the grass slopes down into the rocky hollow.
That's a deep bowl carved out of the rock full of water. A little well.
It's always full. Look at this S marked at the lip of the bowl. It was said to be the sign of the saint who conquered the snakes in Cornwall.
I don't think he did too good a job in your but.
She was rumoured to be a woman saint who had command over the snakes because she was the queen of them. They returned after the mine disaster, it said, and the ghosts of the dead miners lived on in them. You can see how the S looks like a snake sipping at the water. Drink from my hands. This water has travelled through the sky, over all the lands in the world. It has soaked through the jewels and the palaces of the rock. Its taste is life.
Hysterical condition. We've got work to do, my lad, and we won't get it done by you mooning about in Cornwall. You're writing that book with me or not at all. I won't take second place to a perfect stranger.
She was very angry. She called you a perfect stranger, which is absolutely true. What is that written on the lintel?
Drac orto athibo drocanotho. It's difficult to translate. It means love to him who love believes.
Will you marry me?
I will. I must.
Would you even change your name?
Indeed I will.
Your great old name, Rose Trelamia. Your saint's name?
It is very far from that.
John, I will do everything I can to preserve our relationship. Of course, profitable in the personal sense too, yes. But now you are saying that you must marry this woman and bury yourself in Cornwall with her to study your theories about Cornwall stones telling stories. Naturally occurring LSD aerosols and electrical vapours? I dare say. Listening to Gaia, the earth spirit, through the moaning of the mines? Well, that's very good indeed, but we've got to get our book written. We can't work by post. You say the material is dependent on the goodwill of this woman, that she is the seer, but are we or are we not scientists? You're besotted! She really has got you in her toils. If you hang up on me, I'll come straight down. Hello? Oh, you have hung up.
Love be to him who in love believes.
Say it.
Droc oto a...
Adibo.
Adibo droc anotho. The lady is entering her own labyrinth.
I come here whenever I can to listen to the mime.
Oh, I shouted the lioness poem into it, and my name. Oh, I want to stay here forever with you and our child.
Lioness was the name of the great peninsula that once stretched from here to the Isles of Scilly. It was a land like Atlantis, dedicated to all forms of magic. But in a great earthquake, it sank beneath the waves.
How do we know if everybody was lost?
One man escaped on a fast horse, racing the tidal wave. His name was Trevelyan.
Oh, that's Joshua's name. It's on his shop, Trevelyan Serpentine Works. Here's the circle of trees now.
We should make our child here, by the open shaft, in the sound of it, and its snake breath smell of rock and water and gems, in its shifting sound like an ear into the earth depths of the body of Gaia.
Oh, maybe the spirit of one of the old miners, made great by his long sojourn as a wise snake in the depths of the goddess's body, will enter us and be reborn.
I love you. It is the time now. The full moon is rising and the mine is drumming. It is the time.
Copper has colors different in the ores, as various as the rainbow, black and blue, and green and red and yellow as a flower. Gold colored here, there dimly visible, though rich the same in measure and in mead. 'Tis found alike where glittering granite gloams, where killers darkens, and where gossans shroud, and oft where wise ones write it cannot be, thus wisely scattered by the hand divine.
Tin is most secret far, with duller eye oft hiding in the river's shingly bed, or the flint's bosom near the central fires, in chambers wide, or veins like silken lace, so that the labourer, stumbling on a start, wipes his hot brow and cries, "Lo, here is tin."
Do you think there's tin in the stream?
What? Tin? You've been dreaming again, John.
Yes. Some voice which was partly yours was telling me about the mine.
Perhaps it was the mine telling you about itself.
Listen. The drumming has stopped. The sea sound is soft and very far away. Did you bring me here so that I could hear the earth speak its poetry aloud?
I've often drowsed here by the open mine, and heard sounds and seen dreams that have given me life and made me want to write. But never before with another person.
Have we made another person?
I believe it. I believe it.
Clemens is out. Please speak after the tone.
Clemens, you must not come here and disrupt it all.
I tell you, I've had a direct experience of this wonder. We made love. I don't see why you should mind. And I heard the mind talking about itself. I heard the meditations of the earth spirit on its substances, on copper and tin, in beautiful poetry, near the central fires and chambers wide, or veins like silken lace, so that the labor, stumbling on a start, wipes his hot brow and cries, "Lo, here is tin."
Copper has colors,
Clemence,
in the ores, as various as the rainbow, as black and blue and green and red and yellow as a flower.
What are you doing here at Mrs. Treviles? I was phoning...
I heard. Gold-coloured here, there dimly visible, though rich, the same in measure and in mead. I know that poem. It's by John Harris, the poet miner of Camborne and Falmouth. It's in the local guidebook. Look, on this page. Did it never occur to you, my poor dear John, that this woman, after making love and getting a child from you, as she hopes, and winning your devotion into the bargain by all this mystical claptrap about the land speaking, simply whispered the poem into your ear after sex? It's a con, my dear, a con. The poem was already written by a man who had been there, not by some visitor dreaming on the brink of a mind full of death.
Clemence, the spell, the beauty, it was all wonderful.
Pixelating, you mean? You've been pixelated by a woman using all her wiles of cunning. The magic, her home, the well water, the magic circle of the mine. You'd best get away as soon as you can. We'll go together this instant. What was that?
The great serpent shifts her coils. It was an earth tremor, Clemence.
Then that is why you are as you are.
Your own mind is far from immune. You are thinking and acting as the earthquake directs.
Not true. I haven't been here during the build-up. My mind is as clear as crystal. As for your valley, I've been reading up about it. They feared sabotage at the mine, and so they set guards day and night when the men were working. The guards said there was a woman living there who brought them food and drink that was drugged, so that they saw the shining people and serpents who could talk coming out of the ground, and that was why they neglected their duties, and that was why the man engine failed, killing all their comrades.
I can feel another tremor gathering under our feet. Let me out, Clemence. I cannot bear a roof over my head.
You listen to me. There have always been stories of this snake that destroys men.
This is a woman we are talking about, and a woman I love.
Oh, so the earth moved under you when you loved her, did it?
Oh.
I speak in images, but you can see you're not safe with such a woman. She has hypnotized you like the snake does its food, and she is swallowing you slowly in great snake rhythms.
I won't listen to you, Clemence. I love her, and I'm going to her.
John! You must not go through Trelamia's wood tonight. John! He's gone, Mrs. Treviles.
If you'll excuse my saying so, I think he's got into bad company. He was always visiting Trelamere's valley.
Are you Cornish, Mrs. Treviles?
I've been here 20 years. Cornish is anybody by law, married into it. But they still treat me as a visitor.
Did you feel the earthquake?
No, miss. That's the Concorde breaking the sound barrier on its way to America.
It happened more than once. Perhaps they're blasting somewhere.
I think it's Concord.
Do you know Rose Trelamia?
I see her in the village from time to time. Must be funny for her. I mean to have the same name as the valley. Especially as it's supposed to be the name of the great snake that haunts it and swallowed all the miners.
The name? Lamia. Lamia. I knew there was something.
It means a snake, doesn't it?
Yes. That is the name of the great black goddess Lilith in her serpent form. Liliths and Lamias. It's the being Keats wrote about in his poem, Lamia. It beguiles and betrays young men. Her throat was serpent, but the words she spake came as through bubbling honey for love's sake.
Well, I'm not a Cornish speaker, Miss Clements, but look at the dictionary here.
Yes. Tray. The prefix means home, homestead, tribe, clan, dwelling place. Tray, Lemia, the place of the snake.
That bears me out, then. I always said she walked snaky sly, that one. That magic of hers, the healing...
John! My John! Why, he's been pixelated by a ghost. No, more than a ghost. A Cornish goddess. I must go there quick by road.
Oh.
I can get to her cottage before John does. I'll kill that snake bitch if I have to!
Well, it all fits, doesn't it? Mind how you go!
Shocks again. What a strange vibration. It seems to shake the land, but I think that is because it makes you a little dizzy first. What is that in the wind? The setting sun dazzles. There, beyond the trunks of the trees, something vast, silver grey, gliding. Oh! The woman is there, standing in the arch, barefooted in the stream.
So you're John's Clemence. Why are you here?
I've come to persuade you to let John go.
Let him go? He's a grown man. We have something you'll never understand. Where is he now? Let him speak for himself.
He's coming by the wood. Meanwhile, we have things to say to each other. I think you have seduced him with your pretty cottage and your wood and your drinks of water.
Would you like to taste that water? Come with me. What does the inscription over the lintel mean?
Drakoto alibo drakanodo. It means evil be to him who evil thinks. It is a royal motto. Oniswaki malipon.
Water is disgusting. Did you seduce him with that?
It is pure water.
Purity is not disgusting.
Only to the impure.
The world is full of legends of snakes who have turned themselves into women to entrap men.
Do you believe these legends?
I believe what is behind them. That a woman will do anything to get a child from the man she desires, and do anything to feed the child, whether it is to wreck ships or seduce devoted men from their duty guarding the mine.
If this is true, then you must hate all women but yourself. Can you not credit the magic of love?
Magic, yes. I think women may be the vehicle for an earth force they cannot understand, and that is the reason for the legends. The earth force is always symbolized by serpents.
I was a woman. Let me have once more a woman's shape and charming as before.
You are playing with me, Rose. We can bandy Keats' story of Lamia all night while we are waiting for John. A virgin, purest-lipped, yet in the lore of love, deep-learned to the red heart's core.
According to Keats' poem, I should have vanished by now. The keen eye of the philosopher, Apollonius, or Clemence, having discerned my secret and called me Serpent, I should simply disappear from the bridal feast.
I believe that living in this valley, you have been able to draw on the energies that were wicked before you became wicked. Of Lioness, of the wicked shipwreckers and landlords. Imagination or reality, when I arrived, I saw your other form in the wood.
Miss Clemence. I think the little earth shocks have addled your head. The important thing now is, where is John? We'll hear him singing as he comes.
I tell you, I will take him away by road. You shall not have him.
He must be among those stones on the hill, trying to pass the mine in the dark. I will go to him. I can guide him.
Go then. I'll not enter the dark wood with you. Snake bitch. She can shape-shift all she likes in there. So, this is the cottage where they were going to study and bring up their marvellous, magical child. Oh, it does seem safe and secluded. I wish... Oh! Oh! The world's breaking! Oh! It picked me up and flung me down! Was it only this valley or the whole world? A stream in the moonlight. It's running black.
Hello. As I understood you on the phone, they went into the wood and never came back.
No. She went into the wood to find him. Oh, what's the use? She went in and there was an earth tremor and nobody came back.
I don't think so, madam. There is sometimes blasting at this time of the evening, but we've not had an earthquake for years now.
But look at these cracks in the wall!
Well, they're old cracks, madam.
I tell you, there was a tremendous roar, like some hungry beast from in the wood. I demand you search for them.
Oh, very well, miss. Tom, Paul, get the torches. It's really a very small wood. Won't take us long. Your friends are not there. I'm afraid there's nothing we can do.
Oh, no.
There must have been underground subsidence. A mine shaft has closed. Various cracks and fissures have opened in the woods. Nobody responded to our calls. We shall have to search the new fissures in the morning.
Excuse me?
Oh, Miss Clements.
You know my name.
I know most things around here.
Can I buy this serpentine vase?
You can, my lover.
Our friends are still in the wood.
They are, that. The wood is their tomb, and the green stones their monument, like so many others of that valley.
Do their ghosts come back as snakes?
There are no snakes. It's the sunlight whirling between the branches.
And the pixelation.
If that's what you like to call it.
Would you teach me Cornish? There's something in this country I need to know. Something I need in my very bones.
I will, my dear.
The cottage is for sale.
Drock ortho a thibo, drock anotho.
Drock ortho a thibo, drock anotho.
Nigh hither, put off thy shoes from off thy feet, for the place whereon thou standst is holy ground.
What did you say?
Oh, I saw you come out of the wood through the brook with your shoes in your hand, and I had to say something appropriate. Would you like some tea?
Oh, yes, especially after tackling that wood of yours.
Then sit down, please. I'll bring you our best Cornish cream tea, my lover. Would you like it in the house or out here?
Wait a bit. I thought I was lost, but I followed the singing couple out of the wood. Where are they? I'd like to thank them.
Nobody came out of the wood.
They must have gone on. Listen. You can still hear them singing.
The Valley of Trelamia was written by Peter Redgrove and starred James Aubrey as John and Maggie Tarver as Rose. Clemens was played by Sarah Bedell, Mrs. Treviles by June Barry, Joshua by John Church, The Barman and Policeman by Graham Padden, and The Young Man by Mark Audley. It was directed by Brian Miller. Next week we present the first part of a reading of H.G. Wells' anti-war story, A Dream of Armageddon. It's anything like my dreams. Just as I'm about to avert Armageddon, my legs will slow like they're in treacle, and I'll realise I'm not wearing any trousers. Oh, and all my teeth will fall out. Put that in your pipe and smoke it, Sigmund.
BBC Radio 4 Extra. The Seventh Dimension.
Well, next up, a fishy tale of the mermaid, fishy tale, get it? And the rat catcher. Esteemed Irish actor Gerard McSorley reads Moy McCrory's evocative tale from her short story collection, Those Sailing Ships of His Boyhood Dreams.
When the ratter stumbled out of the bar, he was drunker than they all remembered seeing him, and there were no strangers to the sight of Flanagan roaring drunk. All day he pulled his body, dragging the dead half behind him and cursing the cruel god who had fashioned him this way. Bushmills killed the pain, so did powers taken neat, and any temperance leaguers in the district knew to give him a wide berth. Even Father Malachy recognised a soul who'd suffered enough and gave him easy penance each time he came creeping into the dark world of the confessional with a hangover like a hatchet in his skull. They were used to finding him sprawled wherever he'd dropped the night before, by the side of a track, at the bottom of a ditch, or in someone's barn. There were some college girls in the bar that night, down for the weekend to go sailing. So Sean the driver and Gormley Eyesight got him talking for sport.
"Here, come on, give us some of your crack," they called.
Real men were inviting him into a world of golden glow and brotherliness. Gormley Eyesight winked one bulbous look.
"We out at the Leonard's the day."
Suspicious and slow like an animal, the Ratter took the small glass held towards him. "Aye," he said, and with one tip of the head he emptied it. The drink warmed his chest. Sean the driver got him another, and Flanagan felt the heat of friendship pour away doubts.
"How many did you get then?"
"Ah, Jesus, 10 big bruisers."
10? Is that all?"
Gormley Eyesight opened his goitered eyes wide. They seemed to genuinely pop. He stared in two directions. The college girls giggled. "Jesus, they were the size of pups. Brown ones, black ones, chestnut-backed, sleeked. They all came sniffing, with glossy fur biting with their wild teeth." The Ratter swallowed the ball of malt. Gormley Eyesight bought him another.
"He's an expert,"